Is this finally the fix for violent crime? Plus, huge numbers of Americans watched the big TV debate. Why is it so hard to get our local candidates to debate on TV? Are they camera shy? Those stories and more straight ahead on Week in Review.
Week in Review is made possible through the generous support of Dave and Jamie Cummings, Bob and Marlise Gourley, Haas and Wilkerson Insurance, the Courtney S. Turner Charitable Trust, John H. Mize, and Bank of America N.A. co-trustees. And by viewers like you. Thank you.
Hello, I'm Nick Haines, and glad to have you with us as we connect the dots on the top stories of our week. Checking in with us on the big screen, 41 Action News anchor and reporter Dia Wall. From KNBC 9 News, chief political reporter Michael Mahoney. From the Cole newspaper, managing editor Eric Wesson. And from KCUR News, Mr. Up-to-Date, Steve Kraske. Now, just days after 200 federal agents and investigators left Kansas City, Mayor Quinton Lucas announces a new plan to fix rampant crime. It comes as Kansas City is on target to have the highest number of homicides on record this year.
We wish to hear from every neighborhood, every organization in Kansas City.
We all want this to change. We do not want the shooters in our city being as active as they are. I mean, it's night after night.
Violence in Kansas City is a public health epidemic.
Now, we heard lots of buzzwords on the steps of City Hall, words like intervention and prevention, Dia Wall. But is there anything different in this plan that we haven't heard from this mayor or previous mayors at this point?
No, I do think they wanted to make a joint statement, right? A unified force. We're all coming out against crime. But here's the thing, Nick, we did a piece just this week with one of the reporters at our station talking about who wasn't there is just as important as who was. I think that the public, people in our community are tired. We have announced how many crime initiatives, crime plans, but the numbers keep going up. And I think from my standpoint, we've seen months of protests asking for more from Kansas City police in terms of accountability and how they respond and their engagement and what that looks like. And it just feels like every time we get to this point when we want to have a conversation about crime, the onus gets placed on the community. And the community leaders we talk to are just tired of that.
There was an awful lot of people behind the mayor and the police chief and the prosecutor, Eric Wesson. If some people weren't there, who were they? And why did they not decide to participate?
The Jackson County Sheriff, Daryl Forte, wasn't there. That was noticeable. The county executive, Frank White, wasn't there. That was noticeable. But I thought the interesting thing about it was the optic of it all together, that we're all coming together as a unified force. But you had the prosecutor on one side, the police chief on the other side, and you know they don't like each other. And there were several council members that were missing. The ministers weren't there. It's my understanding that they weren't called and invited. It sounded good, but we've been down this road so many times, it's like, what's going to be different about this time?
Well, let's ask Michael Mahoney that, because it's easy to feel jaded about this issue, but it's not an easy problem to fix. So were there any pearls that were different in this for you, Michael?
Well, I've always believed for a long time, Nick, that if you look at the safest neighborhoods in any community, they're not the ones with the most cops. They're the ones with the most stable economics. And a big element of this is not more cops and not getting tough on it, although that's certainly a component, no question about it. The way that you get any neighborhood, any community, any country out of violence is to improve the economy and give people jobs, give people a sense that they got skin in the game.
How does this plan in any way do that, Steve?
Well, what was interesting to me, Nick, and I think one of the underreported aspects of this plan was this notion that the Jackson County Prosecutor's Office is going to go back to something that looks very much like Casey Nova from a year or two ago. This idea where you reach out to potential criminals and say, either straighten up your act or you're going to jail. And, Nick, and this is the important part, for a lot of these people, there are offers of jobs, offers of education here. There was a big split between Gene Peters Baker and the police chief over whether Nova should continue or not. I don't know if the police chief's on board with this or not, but clearly the prosecutor's office has pushed for it, and it's back in the plan right now.
Well, one component with regards to the police chief was he writing on his blog this week that because of COVID cuts brought about by less tax money coming into City Hall, they could see 400 patrol officers and support staff lost if these cuts go into play.
This is according to the police chief now, okay? Year after year after year, Kansas City police get more money. Even the mayor, who some want to call anti-police, has always approved more and more money for the police department. But here's the problem. When you talk about public safety in Kansas City, like a lot of cities, almost three full quarters, like 74-75% of the general fund, the money that they have some flexibility with, goes to just police and just the fire department. So when you're talking about the impact of COVID, sales tax revenues are down, right? Businesses are shutting all over the place. There's no money to pull from. And so at the end of the day, when you're asking everybody to tighten their belts, I get it. I understand we want to fund public safety because it is important, and Kansas City is dealing with a significant crime issue. But where's the money coming from? There's nowhere else to cut.
This was a trial balloon by the police chief. I don't think Rick Smith has a bone in his body or a cell in his DNA that will allow him to lay off that many cops. I don't think Quentin Lucas is going to do it. This is a trial balloon. They've got until May to do something. That's what this is. They're going to figure something out. Every good administrator does this when they're faced with cuts. They give everybody a doomsday scenario.
But they have canceled all of the recruitment classes, Police Chief Rick Smith says, not just this year, but potentially for next year too, Eric Wesson. So there won't be any new officers coming into the police department.
I am absolutely certain that there's a lot of fat in the police department's budget. Are they still doing helicopters? Are they still, one of the things that he wanted to cut from the budget was the PAL program with youth. So I know that there's some excess spending in their budget that we could trim out to make up. And to say that we're not going to have officers in recruitment, I just don't buy that.
Steve,
I really don't.
Well,
Just to be real clear here, the mayor is saying they're not going to cut police officers off the street. I think what you are going to see are some behind-the-scenes administrative stuff. Maybe you combine the Central Patrol with the East Patrol, that kind of thing. But say what you will about this mayor, and I don't say this critically, he's a highly political animal, and no leader of a city facing the scourge of crime that Kansas City is right now can get away with cutting police officers off the street.
I just want to say,
please,
you are facing an 11% budget cut, and the first thing you say is, we could potentially have to cut 30% of the officers. I'm just putting that out there.
It's interesting, all of this was happening on the steps of City Hall. At the very same time, almost every single night, we have protesters still in Kansas City talking about defunding the police, alarmed still about the role that the police play in dealing with persons of color, citizens of color. All of that going on, though those demonstrations are a little smaller today than when they first started, but those leading the effort have been remarkably persistent. Now, in this year of protest and street action, supporters of President Trump are also taking the streets as well. Thousands gathered at Liberty Memorial over the weekend for a car parade that moved en masse to the Country Club Plaza. Organizers say they're planning four more rallies before Election Day. The next is scheduled for Overland Park next weekend. But is there any evidence that these very public displays are actually changing any hearts or minds, Steve Kraske?
Nick, I think at this point in the campaign, political scientists everywhere will tell you that the electorate is pretty baked in at this point. There just aren't that many undecided people, maybe 3% or 4%. And that's why they say that these presidential debates, as wild as the one was this week, this thing's not going to change that many hearts and minds, to use your phrase, Nick, because people have already made up their minds on this thing.
Dear.
I completely agree. I think that we do it out of the tradition and the spirit of a presidential campaign and an election season, but I don't think too many people's minds are going to change at this point. I mean, we're weeks out.
Did you watch the debate this week? More than 73 million Americans tuned in to see President Trump square off against Joe Biden in the first presidential debate.
Like he doesn't know how. He doesn't know how
I've
to do that.
I've already fixed it.
He has never
I've
offered a plan.
Fixed it to an extent.
He has never done a single thing.
Obamacare, as you might
thing.
Know, but probably don't. Obamacare
gentlemen, you realize if you're
good,
both speaking at the same time.
The primetime television spectacle was dubbed the Super Bowl of politics by some analysts. But if they're so important, why aren't we seeing any television debates where we live? Have you noticed there aren't any? The U.S. Senate candidates in Kansas agreed to one radio debate on a weekend afternoon, but have not confirmed plans for a joint exchange on TV. In Missouri, the only scheduled governor's debate was called off after Mike Parson tested positive for the virus. And in the Kansas 3rd Congressional District, Sharice Davids refusing every overture to debate on television. For all the talk about the power of debates, do the candidates no longer care about them, Michael?
The debate and TV debates in Senate races, gubernatorial races, that sort of thing, seems to be going the way of the torchlight parade. They just don't exist anymore. And when I talk to professionals in this, the main thing that anybody wants to do in a debate anymore is not convince voters to vote for them because, as Steve mentioned and Dia mentioned, a lot of people have already made up their minds, even in the Senate and gubernatorial races. What they want to do is not screw up, do no harm. And even if you have a good debate many of the times, it's a wash. You don't pick up anything. Campaigns are not that interested anymore in having a series of debates, and it's not happening here in Kansas. It's not happening here in Missouri. And this is going to be the trend in the future.
Steve.
You know, we're sitting here, to Michael's point, Nick, we're sitting here on the first day of October, and there are no scheduled debates in the race for Missouri governor. There may be one TV debate in that Senate race in Kansas. But think about this for a moment. You have an unelected governor in Missouri who's been around for 2.5, 3 years. People don't know who he is. And as we sit here today, there's a real possibility of no debates in that race for governor. And Mike Parson's calculating that, hey, he's far enough ahead right now. He doesn't need a debate. To Mike's point, all he has is everything to lose here. But this is not a good scene, not a good look for a state where people don't know who their governor really is.
To your point, I think Sharice Davids knows her vulnerability, right, when it comes to a live televised debate. I think that, you know, I was supposed to cover the gubernatorial debate in Missouri, and I will say I recognize that Governor Parson has been, you know, confirmed to have a case of COVID, but he was the only one who had not confirmed even prior to that. So to Mike and Steve's point, there's just no appetite for it.
Are candidates better off spending their money on the phones, raising money to pay for ads that let them control their own message while they're not debating? Have you noticed every commercial break is now filled with those ads? And some of the nastiest are in the Missouri governor's race.
Nicole Galloway abused her office for political gain. Missouri's attorney general says Galloway committed a felony. Nicole Galloway, a disturbing pattern of corruption. Another shady Jefferson City politician.
COVID-19 is ravaging our state, and Mike Parson has failed Missouri on health care. When nearly 100,000 children were removed from Missouri's health care program, Parson failed our children. Time is running out, and we can't afford another failure from Mike Parson.
If these charges were made in a debate, the candidate or the moderator would have the opportunity to challenge the claims. As there isn't any debate on the schedule, can we ask if there's any truth to the claims being made in these ads? Michael, if these were truth watched, would we be stamping a false on them, or is there a grain of truth to them?
A lot of them would get misleading. I'll give you just one example. I could go for the rest of the half hour on just those two spots. When the Democrats say that Parson took 100,000 kids off of welfare, for lack of a better term. Now, Parson did, in fact, restore some of that, and some of those kids did get back on. So it's one of those things where there's more to it than the story. In a debate, there might be a chance for the other side to call somebody out on that, but that relies on the skills of the people that are on the podium in the debate. And so the best opportunity are these fact checks that news organizations do. The problem is an ad will run 50 times, maybe 500 times. That truth check runs once or twice, maybe three times.
Steve.
The losing proposition for the media, Nick. Mike is absolutely right. We can't call these people out very effectively. Having said that, I want to point out that one of the ads that a GOP PAC ran against Nicole Galloway in Missouri actually has been pulled by a series of 9 TV station managers across the state because it was false, and the ad has since been modified. So there was some response here, I guess, in the name of justice and goodness, I guess.
By the way, this week, President Obama endorsed Mike Parson's opponent, Nicole Galloway, and pretty much every high-profile Democrat running in Kansas and Missouri, with one noticeable exception, no endorsement for Barbara Beaulieu, the Democrat running for the United States Senate seat in Kansas. Was that an oversight quickly, or did she beg the former president not to endorse her, Steve?
No, she did not want the endorsement, Nick. Just look back in 2016, 2012, Obama just got 38% of the vote in 2012. In 2008, he just got 41%. Barack Obama, not very popular in Kansas, wasn't going to help Barbara Beaulieu very much at all.
Now, before we move away from our election politics segment, there are a couple of debates you can see on TV, and they're coming your way next Wednesday night. This election year, justice is on the ballot. Protesters demanding change across America and right here in our own backyard. While the focus is on our police, what about our prosecutors? From rising crime to who's getting charged and why and for how long? Two back-to-back debates from both sides of our state line. The Jackson County prosecutor takes on her opponent, and the Johnson County DA takes on his challenger in an election year like no other. It's Justice on the Ballot, Wednesday at 7 on Kansas City PBS. And a reminder, that's just ahead of the vice presidential debate Wednesday night. The Kansas City Parks Board, which has already been wrestling with how to honor Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., now has a new assignment. The city council has unanimously directed the board to examine local street names and monuments to see if they should be removed because of ties to racism and slavery. The Star has been poring through the history books to uncover a number of possible names that could be on the chopping block. But does the council or the Parks Board have any specific streets or monuments in mind, Eric Wesson?
No. One of the ones that are throughout the community, of course, is Truth. Linwood has come up a couple of times as well. But I don't know if they have submitted that information to the Parks Board. But it's going to be interesting, not only the street names, but the statues, the monuments here locally, whether or not they're going to be removed and put in the garage or what. But I do know the Truce was one of the first ones that I heard people talking about.
So the Parks Board, dear, is charged with creating a plan to remove memorials and monuments, quote, of figures that held slaves, promoted racism, or participated in the oppression or dehumanization of others. Could that be an incredibly long list?
Yes. Yes. And this is the problem when we don't have an accurate conversation or teaching of our history, right? So almost every major city, metro in the country has a Jackson County. You know what I'm saying? So this could go far, wide, and deep. I do understand the calls for a lot of these statues and monuments to be removed on a public square, for example, or at county offices and official buildings. But the struggle is going to be, who determines what the bar is? Is it owning slaves? Is it having a comment where you endorse slavery? I mean, this could really be a huge shift and a big, tall order for the Parks Board.
Okay, Michael, is it the Parks Board that ends up deciding this? Is it the city council? Is it the public through a vote on the ballot?
Yes, to all three on that. And they're going to be able to more effectively address the idea of statues and that sort of thing than they are on the streets. Because just go back to the Paseo debate here in Kansas City. One of the problems with it was the process. And the second problem is part of a kickback on it is a lot of people did not want to be go through the hassle of having to have their address changed. And if it's Warnell or it's Troost, it's going to be like the Paseo, the same sort of thing. People are going to push back on this for the more simply the fact that their address is going to change and it's not going to be on the merits of the history on it. So the monuments, that'll happen pretty quickly. The streets, not so much.
Now, this is not just an issue playing out on the Missouri side of state line. Johnson County officials say they're committed to change after a complaint that a stream that flows through the Ironwoods Golf Course in southern Overland Park is officially called Negro Creek. Will it be renamed, Steve?
No, it's not clear yet, Nick. It's interesting because some of the civil rights groups out there are not taking offense to the name of that creek. There's going to be a conversation that ensues here. Some folks point out that the word Negro is Spanish for the word black, and I think this one has to play out a little bit. But what an interesting moment this is. I mean, we just got through the renaming of the J.C. Nichols Fountain, and now it's like the cork has been taken out of the bottle. I'm not sure this isn't a bad way for us to spend some time at least having this conversation about what's appropriate to Dia's point and what's not. That's not a bad thing to do. Whether it results in changes or not, let's see. But we're coming to a certain reckoning with this, and it's an important thing for us to do.
But couldn't it go on a lot longer than we expect? Just like on the Martin Luther King naming, we just had public hearings. There seemed to be a lot of pushback from changing any of the street names even now. And it, have they hit the pause button even on that question, dear?
No, they're still working on it. They've had a couple of meetings, but engagement, you know, people get tired when you've had 40,000 meetings about the same issue. And so I think the challenge here is not necessarily what we do from here. It's how much of an appetite do people really have to go through this line by line by line over and over and over. And I think that if I learned nothing else from the airport project, it is that in Kansas City, you need to have support and input from the community before you start making plans about what you're going to do. You cannot make this plan as a parks board or a city council and then enforce it upon the people there. There are people who love the name Wardle, people who love the name Troost. When they renamed the Paseo, the overwhelming majority of people reaching out to us, Black folks, who say, hold up, I live on the Paseo. Let's leave it the way it is. And so I think it's going to take some community engagement, to Steve's point, to figure out how Kansas City wants to handle this.
Eric.
And it even gets back to the Dr. King acknowledgement. And a lot of people have said, you know, let's just do something and get it over with. But now when you get to the stretch from Cleveland over on 50 Highway, you have Swope Health Services there. If they change the name of that street, they would have to change all of their licensing. They would have to change a lot of things. Shops on Blue Parkway has been branded and marketed for 11 years as Shops on Blue Parkway. The owners can't change it to Shops on MLK. That would just about make that a non-existent issue for as far as attracting businesses to come and be a part of that. So it's not as easy as it seems with these street names.
The hair on your head has become a hot topic this week as well, as members of the Kansas City, Missouri City Council debate a new ordinance to end hair discrimination. City Council members Rihanna Parks Shaw and Melissa Robinson say the measure is needed because of cases where Black people have been denied jobs, educational opportunities, and housing because they had dreadlocks or other natural hairstyles. Now, I've seen stories of this happening in other communities, including high school wrestlers being forced to cut their hair before they can compete. But what is the evidence of discrimination here, dear?
You know, I have not heard personally of cases, but I do think there's something to be said for the protection, right? As the Black woman of the panel today, I will tell you that we've come a long way in the last 5 or 10 years, but even when I started my career, you know, I wore my hair short, natural, curly. I was an anomaly. I mean, there were jobs, there were news directors in this business who would say, well, we like you, but could you just wear your hair straight? And so I think that sometimes it's about the symbolism of a thing more than it is about the legislation. The legislation is there to protect folks if they do need that. But I think it's important. I think it's an important step for any city and for this community in particular to take, because we are evolving as a society. And I don't think your hairstyle should be something that is a barrier for you.
How would you be able to tell, though, that somebody is being discriminated just based on that, Michael Mahoney? Isn't that going to be difficult to prove?
Yeah, it'll be real difficult to prove, but I just want to ratify what Dia said 1,000% there. This is the sort of thing that needs to be there for the protection. It came up and died in the Kansas legislature this year. Yeah, same thing happened in Missouri. It's not so much that you're going to be able to say, aha, right here. It's that, you know, it shouldn't even be an issue.
Steve.
You know, all that's right. And just to point out that sometimes, in some cases, employers might come out and say, I'm not going to hire you because of your hair. It's that direct, it's that blatant, and there's your evidence, Nick. That's how it pops up.
When you put a program like this together every week, you can't get to every local story making the headlines. What was the big story we missed? Was it the Chiefs, now officially ranked number one team in the NFL? Which is more important, news of a royal baby or a Mahomes baby? The mayor of Parkville hits the headlines arrested on suspicion of drunk driving. As more schools get ready to bring back high school students next week, some districts say they may be forced to shut down due to a lack of staff and substitute teachers. And it's your last chance. Deadline day for completing your census form is Monday. Eric Wesson, did you pick one of those stories or something completely different?
Something different. Dr. Mark Bedell is in the race for a national honor among great city schools for turning around the Kansas City, Missouri Public School District. That is a phenomenal honor for him, and to have him in the running. And if you think back 6-7 years ago, you would have never thought Kansas City Public Schools would be in the position it is today, post coronavirus.
Michael Mahoney.
The coronavirus in Kansas is my pick. The health director, Lee Norman, came out in the middle of the week and saying, buckle your seat belts, because this may get worse in Kansas as the fall and the winter goes ahead. It was pretty alarming.
Dia Wall.
You know, I am going to choose something else. I think the biggest news this week is really how this city is going to navigate these budget cuts, and especially in regard to policing, because I think how we handle this situation says a lot about our city and can either set us up for success, or it could just get us into an even deeper spiral of distrust.
And Steve Kraske.
You're all missing the obvious one here. It's the Mahomes baby. Let's pray it's going to be a boy. He'll be number 16, I'm told, if it is a boy, and he's going to succeed Patrick Mahomes as a chief quarterback come 2042 or something like that.
All righty. On that, we will say our week has been reviewed, with great thanks to Dia Wall from 41 Action News checking in with us on the big screen with Channel 9's Michael Mahoney. The Call's Eric Wesson, and Mr. Up-to-Date weekday mornings at 9 on KCUR-FM, Steve Kraske. And I'm Nick Haines. From all of us here at Kansas City PBS, keep calm and carry on.